Well, good evening and welcome back on this glorious Resurrection Sunday to the evening service of New Hope Baptist Church, being live streamed, and we're happy to be with you and glad that you could be with us. I pray you've had a blessed, wonderful Lord's Day. Really do hope and pray you've had time to look through the scriptures, to look at the accounts of Christ's death, burial and resurrection, and to prepare our hearts and minds to be ready to gather around his word as we worship and praise the holy name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, together again this evening. I hope you've had a wonderful day. Perhaps if you are already with family, or maybe you've been Skyping, Zooming, or been in touch with family, whatever you've been able to do, I hope you're having a wonderful Easter weekend in the circumstances and making the very best of the situation that you find yourself in. But we're very glad that you could be with us here again this evening. Well, let us prepare to lift our voices again to open our service together this evening. We're going to sing the hymn One Day. Now, for those of you that are using hymn books, that is 192 in your hymn books, 192. For those of you using hymn books, it will be verses 1, 2, 4, and 5. For everyone else, if you have the printed words on the Word document or the screen words, then we'll be singing all of those that come up on the screen. 192, One Day.
Among men, my example is here.
truth, the Lord is risen. It's Resurrection Sunday, and he's coming again. Do you know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior? Are you ready for when he comes? Are you one of his? I pray you are this evening. Well, if you're in the habit of joining us to stand to sing, now please be seated for our second hymn this evening. That's number 142 in the hymn books, 142. Blessed Redeemer, Blessed Redeemer, redeemed, purchased, bought with a price. And that price was the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Are you redeemed? Are you one of his? Are you saved? Are you a Christian? Are you converted? Are you redeemed? Blessed Redeemer. Jesus Christ. He died for you. He died for me. He died for the sins of the world. He's the Savior of the world to all who will receive him. Believe the gospel, the good news of the Lord Jesus Christ, and receive him. Let's take a moment, shall we, again, and commit this evening's service into the Lord's hands with prayer. O holy and heavenly Father, almighty God, God of grace, God of comfort, God of mercy, God of great provision, God of great power. Our great Father, we humbly yet boldly approach thy throne of grace tonight. Our Lord, we come pleading. Lord, we come praising. We come thanking. We ask, Father, that you would meet with your people tonight by thy spirit and word, that we would worship you and praise you. Our heavenly Father, we pray you would be with each and every one of the people viewing tonight, Lord. Be with them in person. Be with the saved. Bring us comfort. Bring us strength. Give us wisdom for these days. Our Father, we pray again tonight for any that may be with us, spending time around your word, that do not know the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, that are not saved, that are still dead in trespasses and sins and bound for an eternity in hell and the everlasting lake of fire, that this very evening, Lord, you would show them the witness, the truth of your glorious gospel, the truth of what it is to be a sinner, lost and damned, the truth of what it is to be a saint, saved and cleansed. We thank you for your very great and precious promises in your word. We thank you, Father, that you're with us in these days and times. We thank you, Lord, that you lift us, you lift our spirits, you lift our hopes and hearts. We pray tonight heavenward that we may set our affection on things above. Lord, if we have our affection on things of this earth, this is a great time that you've given that we would get our minds heavenward. Help us tonight, Lord, to be blessed by your word. Help me, Lord, as I preach the second part of this gospel message this evening, Lord, be with us to all that's sung, all that's prayed, all that's preached. Be with us through the equipment and everything else, that this may be a service to your praise, glory, and honor through our great and precious Savior, Jesus Christ. In his name, we pray and praise you. Amen. Amen. Well, we do appreciate those of you that stayed with us this morning, and we know there was a technical difficulty, and if for any reason you weren't able to rejoin with us when the message got cut for about somewhere between five to ten minutes this morning, then please do check that out on YouTube, and you can find the finish of this morning's message if you weren't able to get it this morning. Do pray for us this evening that all will be unhindered as we come around the second part. For those of you that did stay with us throughout all of that, thank you for your patience this morning, and we do hope and pray that we'll not have a repeat of that again this evening. Well, just a couple of updates on prayer requests. We do read this afternoon that our Prime Minister, Boris Johnson, has now been discharged from hospital. We do ask the Lord's people to continue praying for our Prime Minister, for his full recovery, his full healing, that he'll be back to full strength. Pray that he doesn't, as many leaders will, just jump back on the scene too soon. May you know he's got good, faithful and able people. We pray around him to carry the burden at this time, and may he be fully recovered. And God give him wisdom and serenity in this time. We do pray for any that were around him in the hospital. We do pray there was opportunity for Christian witness of the gospel, that he may have heard that he may receive that. We would so greatly desire for our Prime Minister to be saved, to become a Christian. What an incredible outcome that would be from this situation. But praise the Lord that he is out of hospital. We've asked for prayer also this morning. Please do pray for Peter and his family. The funeral of his mother will be this week, we believe on Tuesday. And please do pray for all of their comfort at this time, and pray if there's any way we can minister to them or be a blessing to them, that they may know that we are here for them. But do pray for Peter and his family, please, at this time. Also, just one message I got this afternoon, one of encouragement. Some of you will be familiar with our dear friends, John and Donna Davis, and the team up there at Time for Truth Ministry up in Kidderminster. And they've been busy on their exercise walk distributing those gospel coins that many of you have already seen, those wonderful coins with the gospel message on. And they've been distributing them, leaving them at the end of people's driveways and on walls and around about. And it was just really interesting to see there was around the Bromsgrove, Kidderminster area, there were a number of Facebook messages that broke out as people discovered these coins of treasure with the gospel message on their drive, and some wonderful comments that were made on Facebook. So I do pray for the Time for Truth team up there as they distribute those, and just pray for the folks who found those gospel coins. What a great and innovative way that was to get the gospel out in these times. But pray for any that found them. There were some messages of what great comfort those words were. And I noticed one was from a nurse who'd been on a shift in a COVID positive ward, and what words of comfort brought her to tears, it said on Facebook. So who knows what the Lord will do with the gospel as we can and do try and distribute it any way we can. May the Lord help us to do all we can in these days to bring the message of hope of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ to those who are without hope, without any hope, without Christ in these days. What an encouragement that was. And we do hope that John and Donna and Dee and all of those at TFT are greatly encouraged by the response that they received, such faithful labels. And it was brought praise and a smile to my heart this afternoon as I read this not long before this evening's service. Well, tonight we're going to continue our readings through. We're going through the Old Testament prophets, and we're in the book of Jeremiah, the Old Testament prophet. And we're in Jeremiah chapter 7, which we started last week, verses 1 to 20. This evening, Sam will be reading for us from Jeremiah chapter 7, as you turn there, verses 21 to 34. Jeremiah 7, 21 to 34. Thank you, Sam.
Well, thank you, Pastor, and good evening to you all. And I invite you to please stand with me for the reading of God's Word tonight. We're going to be reading from Jeremiah chapter 7 and beginning in verse number 21. The Word of God reads, "Thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, put your burnt offerings unto your sacrifices and eat flesh. For I spake not unto your fathers, nor commanded them in the day that I brought them out of the land of Egypt concerning burnt offerings or sacrifices. But this thing commanded I them, saying, Obey my voice, and I will be your God, and ye shall be my people. And walk ye in all the ways that I have commanded you, that it may be well unto you. But they hearkened not, nor inclined their ear, but walked in the counsels and in the imagination of their evil heart, and went backward, and not forward. Since the day that your fathers came forth out of the land of Egypt unto this day, I have even sent unto you all my servants, the prophets, daily rising up early and sending them. Yet they hearkened not unto me, nor inclined their ear, but hardened their neck. They did worse than their fathers. Therefore thou shalt speak all these words unto them, but they will not hearken to thee. Thou shalt also call unto them, but they will not answer thee. But thou shalt say unto them, This is a nation that obeyeth not the voice of the Lord their God, nor receiveth correction. Truth is perished, and is cut off from their mouth. Cut off thine ear, O Jerusalem, and cast it away, and take up a lamentation on high places. For the Lord hath rejected and forsaken the generation of his wrath. For the children of Judah have done evil in my sight, saith the Lord. They have set their abominations in the house which is called by my name to pollute it. They have built the high places of Tophet, which is in the valley of the son of Hinnom, to burn their sons and their daughters in the fire, which I commanded them not, neither came it into my heart. Therefore, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that it shall no more be called Tophet, nor the valley of the son of Hinnom, but the valley of slaughter. For they shall bury in Tophet till there be no place. And the carcasses of this people shall be meat for the fowls of the heaven and for the beasts of the earth, and none shall fray them away. Then will I cause to cease from the cities of Judah and from the streets of Jerusalem the voice of mirth and the voice of gladness and the voice of the bridegroom and the voice of the bride, for the land shall be desolate." And may the Lord bless the reading of his word tonight. You may be seated if you're standing, and back over to you, Pastor.
Amen. Thank you, Sam. And again, salutary words from the prophet Jeremiah. But this thing commanded I them, saying, obey my voice. Doesn't that speak to what we were talking about this morning, that all we are required to do is be obedient to the very words of God, to the truth of God? And the nation of Judah, the southern kingdom, who Jeremiah was prophesying to, had gone so far away from God, the Lord condemned them in verse 31, because they were burning their sons and daughters in the fire. They were literally worshiping a false god called Moloch. They had a big cast iron or a steel idol who would have outstretched arms, and they would take one of their babies, one of their children, there'd be a big fire burning in his belly, and they'd actually roll the child down the arms and sacrifice a young baby into the fires of false god. Shocking how far people can go. And of course, many people out there today would say, well, we're so enlightened today. We're not ignorant like those. We would never burn our children in the fire. We would never senselessly kill our babies. Last I saw, there were millions murdered by abortion on the sacrifice, on the altar of the God of personal choice and circumstances. Make no mistake about it, friends, there is no new thing under the sun. We are still a wicked and evil and a sinful people. And our God is God. May we be obedient to his word, to his truth. May we come to the Lord Jesus Christ in full and final forgiveness of all of our sins, past, present, and future. What a great sacrificial Savior we have. Don't kid ourselves that we are better and we are more enlightened. Sin is sin. We may just give it new names, but we are weak and we are wicked people, as we looked at this morning. Well, as we do try and go through this evening, the second part of this message, which we'll come to in a little while, we're looking at the full glory of the gospel, and this evening's message will be part two of that which came this morning, and do hope that you're able to join with us for that this morning. Appreciate if you're taking the time to come back again this evening to do that. If you did miss it, this morning's message should be on our YouTube site, so please do try and catch that there if you missed that this morning in any way, shape, or form. But we'll come to our third hymn this evening as we sing together before tonight's message. Now, those of you that were with us last Sunday evening will remember I started part one, funnily enough, of a message in Philippians chapter 1, the nine marks of maturity, but the Lord laid this on my heart for this week. God willing, if we're all still here next week, then next Sunday evening we'll resume and cover part two of the nine marks of maturity. So I haven't forgotten about that. We'll finish the second part of that message next week, next Sunday evening, God willing. Please do join us if you can on Thursday for the Bible study and prayer meeting, which continues on Thursday evenings at 7 for the Bible study in Daniel. Then that's followed by a time where the church gather via Zoom for prayer time together. It was a great blessing this morning after the message as we gathered for a virtual fellowship time. And we really appreciate everybody who's taken the effort and making the time to join with us together. But it was such a blessing because young Martha, she's what, 2.5, just over now. Her father, Lewin, had her to repeat John 3:16 from memory to us in a sweet little voice. What an encouragement it is. Out of the mouths of babes, the Bible says. It's so encouraging, isn't it? And do pray for every godly family that are doing all they can to raise up godly generations of godly children, raising them according to the Bible. It's an encouragement to our hearts to see that. And what a blessing that really was. So do pray for the Denley family as they await the next baby due on the scene in July. Pray for the Denley family, please, if you would. All right, let's come to number 179 in your hymn books this evening, if you're using those. Wonderful traditional hymn, great truth, 179, Christ the Lord is risen today. 179 in your hymn books.
Praise your joys and triumphs.
words by Charles Wesley, right? Christian soldier of the faith. Well, let's come to the Word of God again this evening as we come back to the full glory of the gospel. And if you would turn back with me to Matthew's gospel and chapter 27 this evening, Matthew chapter 27. If you weren't with us this morning, obviously I wouldn't have enough time to recap fully, but just the thought is this. Well, you're turning there to Matthew chapter 27. Let me turn to 1 Corinthians 15 again this evening. 1 Corinthians 15, the point of going through Matthew chapters 26, 27, and 28, as we started this morning, whether you go through Matthew's gospel account of the death, the burial, and the resurrection, or Mark, Luke, or John's, then they all add something wonderful to the richness and depth. And I do encourage you, each and every one of you, if you've not had a chance yet, please read every one of those accounts. Read them today. Read them this evening. Experience the depth and the richness that can only be drawn out from reading all of those accounts side by side together. But the purpose is it's Resurrection Sunday, and the resurrection is a greatly important part of the gospel message, and that's the gospel that is for the church age. We did try and cover briefly some of those confusions with the gospel last week. But if you're in any doubt, let me read it again. What is the gospel, the good news that saves you in this church age, that saves you and cleanses you and keeps you until the day of your redemption, until the day we've got to be with Jesus Christ? And that's found in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1. Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved. Can I just say this? A lot of people say to us, why do you say, are you saved, in reference to being a Christian? Because it's biblical. The Bible says that if we believe in the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, do we become a Christian? Yes. Are we converted? Yes. Are we regenerated? Yes. But the Bible says we're saved, not lost anymore. Saved, rescued, praise the Lord. By which also you are saved, if you keep in memory what I have preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. We looked at that very first part of the gospel message this morning. We'll pick up on that again this evening. And that he was buried. That's a part of the gospel message. And that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. That's a part of the gospel message. And a confirmation of the gospel message then follows in verse 5 and 6 and says, and that he was seen of Cephas, that's Simon Peter, then of the 12. After that, he was seen of above 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain unto this present, but some are fallen asleep. The gospel is presented as a matter of fact. The facts are simply stated. The witness accounts are simply stated in the gospel records. They contain incredible, miraculous, awe-inspiring truth, yet presented as matter of fact. Incredible. Matthew chapter 27, as we go back there this evening, looking at the full glory of the gospel. So in light of 1 Corinthians 15, 1 to 6 that we've covered tonight, the death, burial, and resurrection that just rolls off the tongue, then we're actually spending the day looking at the death, the burial, and the resurrection in the chronological flow of events as it occurs in Matthew's gospel. This is recorded history. This is not fantasy. This is recorded history. This is the accounts, and the account in particular, Matthew's account, as an eyewitness to these things. This is a witness record. And as I said this morning, just to restate again, I'm not following the normal method that we may use each week in preaching. More of a narrative. More of a narrative with a commentary on a few points along the sides. And as we said, that may not be everyone's cup of tea, and it may not be your cup of tea, but really the Word of God, whenever it's read, the Word of God, whenever it's commented upon, ought to bring a joy and a cheer to our hearts, no matter what. You know, it should not be in being entertained in any way, shape, or form by a preacher. It should be about being empowered by the gospel, by the Word of God, and by the truth of God's Word. So where we left it this morning, we left it in Matthew chapter 27, really left it in verse number 50, when Jesus cried again with a loud voice. He yielded up the ghost. And we looked at John's account where the Lord Jesus Christ said, "It is finished." Christ yielded up his life. He gave up the ghost. He laid down his life. No man took it from him. In full fulfillment of biblical, prophetical scripture, Christ died in our place. He was a substitutionary atonement. He died for you and he died for me. He died for the sins of the world. He died in our place. He shed his precious blood for us. And we left him hanging, if you will, on the cross of Calvary. I mentioned this morning we're staying away from the gnat straining elements. There's so much we could look into in the chronology, which was the day that Christ was crucified. We could look at the numerous Marys around the cross and argue about over all those things. That's not my intention. We're not doing the detail, if you will, this evening, although those studies, of course, are very wonderful. We're sticking purely with the full glory of the gospel. We're just laying it down, putting it down as a record, as an encouragement for each and every one of us tonight. So there's Christ on the cross. We're going to pick it up again. Just look at verse 54 of Matthew 27. Interestingly enough, this was a wonderful comment by the centurion. You know, after the Christ had been on the cross from 9 o'clock in the morning till 3 o'clock in the afternoon, when he yielded his body, when he yielded up the ghost, from midday to 3 p.m., darkness was on the land as the Lord bore the cup of God's wrath and called out the words, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? As Christ took your punishment on the cross for sin, my punishment on the cross for sin, God's wrath on sin for you and for me. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? But after he yielded up the ghost, after his death, verse 54 says, now when the centurion and they that were with him, the centurion and the soldiers on the guard around the cross at Calvary, watching Jesus, saw the earthquake and those things that were done, they feared greatly, saying, truly this was the Son of God. That's a great testimony in and of itself, isn't it? But for this evening, let's pick this up at verse 57, verse 57 of Matthew 27. We'll read the section from verse 57 to 66. We're now looking at the sealing of the Savior in the sepulchre. That's our next point on the journey on through Matthew's gospel, the sealing of the Savior in the sepulchre, a sepulchre, a tomb. Verse 57, when the even was come, there came a rich man of Arimathea named Joseph, who also himself was Jesus' disciple. He went to Pilate and begged the body of Jesus. Then Pilate commanded the body to be delivered. And when Joseph had taken the body, he wrapped it in a clean linen cloth and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had hewn out in the rock. And he rolled a great stone to the door of the sepulchre and departed. And there was Mary Magdalene and the other Mary sitting over against the sepulchre. Now the next day that followed the day of preparation, the chief priests and Pharisees came together unto Pilate, saying, Sir, we remember that deceiver said while he was yet alive, after 3 days I will rise again. Command therefore that the sepulchre be made sure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away and say unto the people, he is risen from the dead. So the last error shall be worse than the first. Pilate said unto them, ye have a watch, go your way, make it as sure as you can. So they went and made the sepulchre sure, sealing the stone and setting a watch. Let's take a minute again and pray the Lord will help us in his word again tonight. Father, we gather around this great account in your word, in Matthew's gospel. We thank you for the Holy Bible, without which we'd be undone. We thank you for truth. And we thank you, Lord, for the Holy Spirit indwelling us, the Spirit of truth. We thank you that you lead us into all truth and we're sanctified by truth. Lord, may we see again tonight the full glory of this gospel, the gospel of the death, the burial, and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, by which we are saved. We pray again this evening the saved would be stirred by the very reading of this account, the lost would be saved, that they would this very evening forget and their fight against you, their war against you, forget the life led in death, in trespasses and sins, but would this very night come from death to life, In the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Amen. The sealing of the Savior in the sepulchre, then, we read, and onto the scene. Here's the evening coming now, the day of preparation, of course. This is before the high Sabbath Passover. This is before the normal day of Passover. So in my reckoning, I would make that indeed a Wednesday evening in Gentile time, if you will. You may think Thursday, you may think Friday, whatever. You do your study, you come to the conclusion that you come to. The Lord just leaves some richness in there for us to argue about if we get bored, doesn't he, sometimes? But here we have a man, a rich man, Joseph of Arimathea, who comes onto the scene. Joseph, hitherto, if you will, one of the secret disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ, thought he had much to lose by coming out openly and boldly to this point. Then those secret disciples are mentioned in John chapter 12 and verse 42, one of whom probably Nicodemus, who'd come to Jesus by night in John chapter 3. Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, both of them become involved with bringing down the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. But Joseph of Arimathea now has had enough of being a secret disciple. He steps out openly. He steps out boldly onto the scene. He goes, if you will, go to Mark chapter 15, Mark chapter 15 and verse number 43. Mark 15 and verse number 43. We see a parallel account, and we see wonderful truth about Joseph of Arimathea. Mark 15 and verse 43 says, Joseph of Arimathea, an honorable counselor, which also waited for the kingdom of God, came and went in boldly unto Pilate and craved the body of Jesus. Keep your finger there if you would. He came and went boldly unto Pilate, the governor. Hitherto, he'd been a secret disciple. And there's something that we can learn there, that there are many Christians who maybe live their life secretly, in a sense, for the Lord, or very quietly, not boldly stepping out, not boldly standing forth. And the Lord can use all Christians in many, many ways. But I wonder sometimes, Christian, what is it that will make you step out boldly? What is it that will make you step out openly? Here it was the truth that Jesus Christ had been crucified. Maybe he just felt so emboldened because of the wrong that he felt had been done. He didn't understand the Lord Jesus Christ was going to be crucified. To him, it was the last step in his secrecy as a disciple. He was boldly stepping forth in front of Pilate. A very interesting choice. But may I say to you, what is it that will make you step out boldly, Christian? It ought to be in the truth of the fact that we have a risen, living, ascended Savior. May the Lord help us to be bold witnesses in these times, to stand out and to stand forth for the Lord Jesus Christ. We've said so many times recently, step over our fear, step up in faith, and step out in love. May the Lord help us to be bold Christians. But still in Mark chapter 15, we see some more in verses 44 and 45 relating to the body of the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross. Mark 15, 44, and Pilate marveled if he were already dead. And Christ had been pitilessly scourged. The scourging itself would kill many a man because it would open the internal organs of the body to the air, the ripping away of the flesh, the muscle, and the sinew. Yet crucifixion itself was a slower death, but the Lord himself had been mercilessly scourged. And Pilate marveled if he were already dead, and calling unto him the centurion. So Pilate wants to check with the centurion that Christ is dead. He asked him whether he had been any while dead. And when he knew it of the centurion, he gave the body to Joseph. There's Christ's body on the cross. Joseph of Arimathea steps out boldly, comes to Pilate, the governor, asks for the body of Jesus Christ, to take it down, to remove it from shame, from view, just out of mercy to crave the body. Pilate's surprised. Is Jesus Christ dead already? He calls the centurion to him. And when he knew it, he gave the body to Jesus. Now we find this because what's the importance of the death? What's the importance of the burial? The death, because the precious blood of Jesus Christ was shed in the gospel. Why is it important that in 1 Corinthians 15:4 it says, and that he was buried? Why is it important that Jesus was dead and sealed in the tomb. Why is it important that we have the witness of the governor that he was dead, the witness of the centurion that he was dead? Why are these things important? Because it removes any of the nonsense that's put around that Jesus Christ, oh, he passed out, but he hadn't passed on. The swoon theory. Christ was in a coma theory. That he wasn't really dead. You know, and when he came to be placed in the tomb, he somehow revived, folded up the grave clothes, took the time to do that, you know, and his disciples led him away. And of course, we're going to find that to be an absolute nonsense, of course. But can I say this? The centurion is an experienced Roman soldier with command over 100 men. He knew death. He was, if you will, an expert in death. There would be no doubt whatsoever in the centurion's mind that Jesus Christ was dead. In fact, if we go to John's Gospel, chapter 19, we get a further insight. I just want to make sure you're not in any doubt whatsoever if one of these foolish people comes up with some new truth that they think they've just discovered that Jesus wasn't really dead and had some kind of come around from a coma in the tomb, folded his clothes and waltzed off into the sunset. Nothing could be any further from the truth. John chapter 19, and I think we'll come to verse 31. John 19, 31. Well, let's look at the end of verse 13. He bowed his head and gave up the ghost. That's putting us in the same place as we were in Matthew's gospel. There's Christ dead on the cross, having given up the ghost. Verse 31. The Jews, therefore, because it was the preparation that the body should not remain upon the cross on the Sabbath day, for that Sabbath day was an high day, besought Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. So remember, Jesus Christ was crucified between the two thieves, and we're getting towards the high Sabbath day. The day of preparation is there upon us, and we don't want to see for Passover, the Jews and the high priests, the chiefs and the elders don't want to see these bodies hanging on the cross, taking the edge, if you will, taking the enjoyment of the Passover feast. Verse 32. Then came the soldiers, who are soldiers, trained killers, experienced in death. The ones responsible to ensure that every person delivered up for capital punishment, the death sentence, actually carried out. A soldier would not want to be neglected of his duty in relation to the death penalty. Then came the soldiers and break the legs of the first and of the other, which was crucified with him. The two men, either side, one either side of Christ. This is a process, it's gruesome, and we won't go into all the details of it, but it's called crucifracture. And if for any reason the process of crucifixion needed to be speeded up, if they wanted to remove the tortuous agony that crucifixion was, for some reason to bring death around swifter, they followed the process of crucifracture. And what would happen, a person being crucified would support some of the weight to try and enable themselves to breathe and stay alive a little bit longer by supporting that weight on the legs and feet. The soldiers in crucifixion would come along with an iron mallet and actually take that heavy mallet and snap, hit the legs and break the bones in the legs. So the legs would collapse and crumble and death would be hastened through suffocation. You wouldn't be able to breathe. That was crucifixion. So we find that the criminals themselves weren't dead. They died after the Lord Jesus Christ, and they died through the process of crucifracture by having their legs broken with an iron mallet. But look at verse 33. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was dead already, they brake not his legs. Those soldiers were in no doubt. That centurion was in no doubt. No one was in any doubt whatsoever that Christ was dead. And then verse 34 says, but one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side, and forthwith came there out blood and water from the lungs, the heart giving out. You can look at all the research and the science behind that. But let me be absolutely sure those details are there for two reasons. The first being so that you and I are in no doubt whatsoever that Christ was dead, fully dead, no fainting, no swooning, no coma, dead, absolutely dead. The soldiers were certain of it. The centurion was certain of it. They would make no mistake whatsoever And Pilate wanted to be certain of it, and he was certain of it. But also we'll find some truths there. We won't have time to look at them tonight about, again, the fulfillment of Scripture about Christ, the Passover lamb. No bone was to be broken in the Passover lamb. So we find Scripture is fulfilled. We also find in Zechariah 12, I think around about verse 10, where it talks about the remnant of Israel at the end of the tribulation, looking upon him whom they pierced. Then we find that Jesus Christ was pierced in his side. So we find all these fulfillments of prophecy in the very fact that Jesus Christ was dead, pierced, and not a bone was broken. The Word of God is a wonderful, wonderful book, isn't it? Such great truths. So there was no doubt whatsoever. Now you say, why is it then important within the gospel that we deal with the body of the Lord Jesus Christ? Why is it important that we understand that he was buried in the tomb? And very, very briefly, let me just say this to you. The Godhead is three: God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And man in his body, if you will, is a trichotomous being: body, soul, and spirit. We won't turn there, but make a note of this reference, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 23, which quite simply shows us this truth. You're more than just a walking body, a walking pile of organs and muscles and sinews. You are a body, but you're also an eternal, living, never dying soul. That soul is bodily shaped, but it is distinctively separate and within your body, and you are spirit. And we find that as a representation. So man is three. The Godhead is three. Man is three. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23 says this: and the very God of peace sanctify you wholly, and I pray God your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. You are soul, spirit, and body. Body, soul, and spirit. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost. Three. Man, body, soul, and spirit. Three. God the Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, incarnate as a body, was also body, soul, and spirit. This is important because he died in our place. Now, we can understand this briefly. Again, don't turn there, but make a note of the reference. Luke 23:46, in a parallel account in Luke's gospel of the crucifixion, says, and when Jesus had cried with a loud voice, he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And having said thus, he gave up the ghost. So we find the Lord Jesus Christ, prior to his death, just prior to his death on the cross, commends his spirit back to God the Father. His body goes into the tomb. His body is buried. How that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried. His spirit goes back to the Father. His body goes into the tomb. We recently did a very interesting study on the 3 days and nights between the death and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. You say, well, what about his soul? Well, you'll find the soul of the Lord Jesus Christ goes down and captures the keys of death and hell. The soul of the Lord Jesus Christ is there somewhere before 6 p.m. at the end of that day. Remember, Christ died at 3. His soul goes down, takes the keys of hell and death, preaches to the spirits in prison, and is in paradise to meet with that thief who was saved on the very cross that day. And the Lord Jesus Christ told him that today thou shalt be with me in paradise. So we find this work of the body of Christ, the soul of Christ, and the spirit of Christ interconnects, because we are body, soul, and spirit, and the Godhead is God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. Because you and I have an eternal, never-dying soul. So Jesus Christ was dead on the cross. Jesus Christ was buried in the tomb. Jesus Christ was dead and sealed in the tomb. But Jesus Christ was expected to come out of the tomb. Now, many people, of course, say, of course. You know, the disciples were looking forward by faith. If you read those accounts, those disciples were unbelieving. They were not looking for Christ to come out of that tomb. They deserted. They were dejected. They were unbelieving. They were not looking for Christ to come out from that tomb. But would you look at verse 63 to see who was? Well, verse 62 of Matthew chapter 27 It says, now the next day that followed the day of preparation, the chief priests and Pharisees came together unto Pilate. So it's the chief priests and the Pharisees, those who'd condemned Christ, those who'd looked for his crucifixion. Now they come to Pilate and said, sir, we remember that that deceiver said, while he was yet alive, after 3 days, I will rise again. Notice they were paying very close attention to what the Lord Jesus Christ was saying. Command, therefore, that the sepulchre be made sure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away and say unto the people, he is risen from the dead, so the last error shall be worse than the first. Do you see, the chief priests and the Pharisees had paid attention to what the Lord Jesus Christ had said, even if the disciples had not. They were expecting him to come out of the tomb. However, they were expecting it by natural and or nefarious means. But nonetheless, they had paid attention to what Jesus Christ was saying. It comes to something, doesn't it? When the worldly, the godless are paying more attention to the sayings of Jesus than the disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ. We should be attentive to the words of Scripture. It's important. But I do like Pilate's response. Look at verse 65, if you would. Pilate said unto them, ye have a watch, go your way, make it as sure as you can. Make it as sure as you can. I think that's God just giving us a little chuckle in the Scriptures. You know, I think Pilate is really saying to them, do your best, guys. But really, what's Pilate seen? He knows he's condemned a just man. He's had that message from his wife that he ignored. He spent the afternoon talking to his wife, following 3 hours of darkness, following earthquakes, etc. He's followed all of that. Now I think he's thinking, maybe this indeed was the Son of God. And I think Pilate is intimating that in the Scripture. I don't want to read into the text. It's just my thought. You can discount it if you don't like it. Make it as sure as you can. Do your best, guys. But I don't think you're going to be able to stop this guy coming out of the tomb. I think that's what he's saying. Isn't that interesting? Isn't that interesting? I think he'd been convicted by the supernatural events of the afternoon. So we see the sealing of the Savior in the sepulchre, verse 66 end. And they went and made the sepulchre sure, sealing the stone and setting a watch. Do you think God wants us to be absolutely certain that Christ didn't slip out through a gap, that the disciples didn't slip in somehow, you know, just roll the stone away quietly? There was a watch. It was sure. It was sealed. It was secure. It was under guard. It was locked down, if you will, as some of us may well be at the moment. So the sealing of the Savior in the sepulchre we now see is followed by the seeing of the place where the Lord lay. As we come back now to Matthew chapter 28, let's look at verses 1 to 6. In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, so the Sabbath is Saturday to the Jews, the first day of the week. In case you're unsure, I know some calendars and diaries today show it as Monday. But the first day of the week, according to the Bible, is Sunday. Sunday. In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene. Remember Mary Magdalene, out of whom had been cast 7 devils? She loved the Lord. Came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulchre. That's the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door. Okay, the angel came and rolled back the stone. The stone was not previously rolled away. Rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers, that's the guards, the soldiers, did shake and became as dead men. They weren't asleep. They were awake. They saw this. They were frightened and they were fearful when they saw the angel of the Lord. And the angel answered and said unto the women, fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. Would you just note that again? The witness from an angel of heaven. Jesus was crucified. He was dead. He was in the tomb. He is not here, for he is risen. And he said, come see the place where the Lord lay. Well, isn't this incredible? The Sabbath is ending. Sunday begins. Now remember, the Sabbath is ending, Remember, the veil of the temple was rent in two. God had finished with the religion of Judaism. The New Testament started with the death of Christ on the cross. Hebrews 9:27, the death of that testator as he died on the cross. And therefore, something new had happened. This is important because I want you to understand Christianity is not a sect of Judaism. It's not. It's something completely new. Give none offense, 1 Corinthians 10:32, to Jew, Gentile, or the Church of God. Something completely new. Christianity is not a sect of Judaism. It's not a slightly modified version of Judaism. There's no such thing as a Christian Sabbath. The Sabbath was for the Jew, implemented under the law. There is no such thing as the Christian Sabbath. That is the law terminology for the Jews. We have the Lord's Day, if you like, a Sunday. They're all the Lord's days, all seven of them. But it's a particular day set aside for worship, the taking of offerings and various things we can look at through scripture, preaching, praying, singing a particular day. But there's no such thing as a Christian Sabbath. Judaism ended. The Sabbath ended. It was all finished. Something new, a New Testament, a new covenant, a new age, the church age, it had begun. The sealed stone was rolled away, not by the disciples. They couldn't have managed it. It was under watch and it was sealed. Not by the women, not by the Marys. It was rolled away by the angel of the Lord. Now, look at the truth of this in verse 4. It says these soldiers, these keepers, were in fear. The soldiers shook. They were shaking in the presence of the angel of the Lord. Soldiers, brave men, fearful, became as dead men on the floor, probably, shaking with fear. Do you know what that says to me? You know how many people, I don't know whether you have the same, who I come across sometimes who say something like this. You know, they profess not to believe in God, but they say, when I get face to face with God, I'll tell him what a wicked, you'll tell God nothing, you unsaved reprobate. You'll be on your face crying, screaming, pleading because judgment is upon you. Your sin will be upon you and you will be in the presence of God Almighty. You will say nothing other than you will plead for mercy and it will be too late. You will plead for forgiveness and it will be too late. You will cry like a little girl and it will be too late then. But it's not too late now. Don't meet God as your judge because you will tell him nothing. These soldiers, brave men, shook and quaked in the presence of one angel of the Lord. False bravery. See the truth. Flee to Christ. The statement was made, ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. We have the testimony of the soldiers. He was dead. We have the testimony of the centurion. He was dead. We have the testimony of Pilate that he was dead. And we have the testimony of heaven that Jesus Christ was dead. He was dead. No doubt about it. No doubt whatsoever. And then we see the sight inside the sepulchre in verse 6. Come see the place where the Lord lay. He wasn't there. He was risen. He was gone. The clothes were folded up, by the way. You wouldn't take the time to do that if you just come out of a coma and your back was scourged and you suddenly realize you were, you know, moments from death, but you'd somehow recovered. I'm sorry, there's just no way any of those things can be true. The evidence dismisses it. They saw the place where the Lord lay. They saw the empty tomb. They saw the empty tomb. But they were about to see the risen Savior. You see, the sealing of the Savior in the sepulchre is followed by the seeing of the place where the Lord lay, is followed by the sending of the messenger. Back to Matthew 28, verse 7 to 10. Look what the angel of the Lord says. He said, and go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And behold, he goeth before you into Galilee. There shall you see him. Lo, I have told you. And they departed quickly from the sepulchre with fear and great joy and did run to bring his disciples word. And as they went to tell the disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, all hail. And they came and held him by the feet and worshipped him. Then said Jesus unto them, be not afraid, go tell my brethren that they go into Galilee, and there shall they see me. Now, if we just quickly look at that with Mark 16, we're going to find out that Mary Magdalene was the messenger. Mark 16, look at chapter 10. Mark chapter 16, look at verse 9 and 10. Now, when Jesus was risen early the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene. Now, you can get this order of these appearances and the worships if you read through all four of the gospel accounts. It amplifies, it sets it out exactly chronologically, who Christ met, when he met them, who he spoke to, who worshipped him, what he said and where he went. But we're just skipping over the details to pull out the salient points for this evening. Now, when Jesus was risen early the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast seven devils. And she went and told them that had been with him as they mourned and wept. Please, 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 please do not follow what the crowd say. When the crowd tell you that the disciples were looking forward by faith to the cross, then there's something wrong. Because if that's true, then something was wrong. Because they're mourning and weeping because they believe Jesus Christ has been murdered and crucified. They weren't sitting there tapping their fingers going, that's 3 days and three nights. Woohoo! Resurrection time, boys, just as he said. They didn't understand it. Look at verse 11. And they which had heard that he was alive. Now, here comes Mary Magdalene. She was the messenger. Mary has a message. And the message is not hearsay. The message is the Lord is risen. The Lord is alive. The tomb is empty. And when they heard that he was alive and had been seen of her, believed not. Doesn't that kind of contrast with these people looking forward by faith to the cross? They were mourning, they were weeping, and when the witness of the resurrected Christ, the first missionary messenger, Mary, comes in with a message of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, they what? Believed not. Friend, believe your Bible. Don't believe tradition. You see, Mary had a message. It was not hearsay. Christ was risen. The tomb was empty. You cannot kill God. The body of Christ was dead, but his spirit was in heaven. His soul was in paradise, and he was coming back to bring it all together and to appear and to overcome death. You know, grave, where is thy victory? Death, where is thy sting? Death had been overcome. I am the resurrection and the life, Jesus said. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. John 11, verse 25. 1 Corinthians 15:4. See, aren't we working our way through the gospel? How that Christ died for our sins, according to the scriptures, and that he was buried and rose again the third day, according to the scriptures. How about verse 4? Verse 5 and 6, and that he was seen. You see, it's all a part of the wonderful gospel truth. You see, the sending of the messenger to the unbelieving disciples nonetheless didn't change the message of truth. But we also, as we go back to Matthew's gospel, as we go back to Matthew 28, look what we see in verses 11 to 15. Now we see the silencing of the soldiers. Matthew 28, Christ is not there. He is risen. Mary is sent with a message. Then verse 11, we come back to these soldiers that had been there, that had witnessed the empty tomb, that had witnessed the angel of the Lord, that had witnessed the stone being rolled away. Verse 11, now when they were going, behold, some of the watch, the soldiers on the watch, came into the city and showed unto the chief priests all the things that were done. And when they were assembled with the elders and had taken counsel, they gave large money unto the soldiers, saying, say ye, his disciples came by night and stole him away while we slept. And if this come to the governor's ears, we will persuade him and secure you. So they took the money and did as they were taught. And this saying is commonly reported among the Jews until this day. It was no secret. You see, we see the silencing of the soldiers because the soldiers confirmed the biblical truth. They went and told the elders, they went and told the chief priest, they went and told the council exactly what had happened. The stone's rolled away. We've seen an angel of God. The tomb is empty. The Lord Jesus Christ, I'm sure they wouldn't have used that term, is gone. Is gone. They were awake through it all because they were fearful. They didn't sleep through it. Don't believe any fairy stories that the soldiers must have been asleep. They were awake, fearful, quaking, and trembling. They saw it all. They saw the same account. They saw the same things. They knew it to be true, and they went and reported to the chief priests and elders, who, if they'd truly been God's people and truly been godly people, what would they have done? They would have asked God's forgiveness upon their mistake. God's forgiveness on their sinful wickedness. They would have sought God in repentance and changed their ways as God's people because they would have known the truth. Late they would have known it, but the truth it still would be. You see, it's not about when we receive the truth. It's about the fact that we do receive the truth. That's important. We must receive the truth of the gospel before we die. Think about this for a minute. If this was on YouTube today, this would be a conspiracy that everybody would believe. We've got soldiers that are witnessing. We'd have the camera evidence. We'd have evidence of a bribe and corruption through the highest echelons of the state. People would be lapping it up, all the conspiracy nuts and crankpots. They'd believe it all. There'd be no problem in believing it. Yet because it's truth, absolute truth, even those that should have then received it, even those who should have known better, the chief priests, scribes, the elders, they wouldn't listen to the soldiers as they confirmed it. In fact, the chief priests conspired to keep it quiet. I won't even drift off into Vatican conspiracies at this point. I won't even drift off into things that are tried to be hushed up and kept quiet. I think we've seen quite enough of that even in recent times. But there we go again with the good, godly, robed priests conspiring to keep the truth quiet. Friends, get away from man-made religion. Get around Bible-believing Christians. Receive the Lord Jesus Christ, get the Word of God, and know the eternal, certain truth. You can know the truth. And as the Lord Jesus Christ said, the truth shall make you free. Oh, it sure will. Chief priests conspiring. But it's all just secondary to the fact the Lord is risen. And now we find the Savior is seen. I mean by the disciples, not just by Mary now. Chapter 28, verse 16 and 17. Then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee, into a mountain where Jesus had appointed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him. But some doubted. They worshipped him. So what's this? This is the infallible proof. This is verse 5 and 6 of 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And that he was seen first by Cephas, then by above 500 brethren at once. He was seen. The infallible proof. He wasn't seen from a distance, glanced and glimpsed. Go through John's gospel. He appeared in a room. He was flesh and bones. Read the parallel accounts. Get your timeline right. See exactly what happened. Christ as flesh and bones could pass into a sealed room. He could eat broiled fish and honeycombs with them. His infallible proofs. Just turn to Acts chapter 1. That's how we see it recorded. Infallible, faultless, without fault, without error. Infallible proofs. This wasn't just a dream. This wasn't just for a passing, fleeting moment of time. We find these infallible proofs lasted for a period of 40 days. Acts chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. Well, let me read from verse 1, Acts chapter 1 from verse 1. The former treatise have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach, until the day in which he was taken up, after that he, through the Holy Ghost, had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion, that's the death, burial, and resurrection, by many, many infallible, without error, proofs. Evidence being seen of them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God and being assembled together with them. And so it continues. Infallible proof. The Lord was seen. You know, John in 1 John chapter 1 talks about the Savior, whom they touched, whom they handled. These are witness accounts. These are evidential accounts, one after another, after another, after another, after another. The evidence stacks up, friend, and you can keep denying it as much as you like. You can keep trying to bat it into the long grass as much as you like. But the truth is, if you're not saved, then the Savior died for you to save you from your sins. And he is a living, risen, ascended Savior. And he's calling you to him today and telling you to believe the glory of the gospel, to believe the witness accounts of the truth, to believe the evidence of your own life. You know you're a sinner, and to be saved. Saved by the glorious truth. What about Luke? Just go to Luke 24, if you would. Luke chapter 24. As I said, do please take the time to read these parallel accounts of the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Luke chapter 24, let's pick it up at verse 36. And as they thus spake, this is following the crucifixion of Christ and his resurrection, as they thus spake, that's the disciples, Jesus himself stood in the midst of them and saith unto them, peace be unto you. But they were terrified and affrighted and supposed that they had seen a spirit. They weren't expecting it. And he said unto them, why are you troubled, and why do thoughts arise in your hearts? Behold my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Handle me and see. For a spirit hath not flesh and bones, as ye see me have. No more blood, but flesh and bones. The blood was deposited. And when he had thus spoken, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they yet believed not for joy and wondered, he said unto them, have ye here any meat? And they gave him a piece of broiled fish and of a honeycomb, and he took it and did eat before them. And he said unto them, these are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you. Christ told them he was going to be crucified, buried, and rise again, but they would not receive it. That all things must be fulfilled. It was the fulfillment of biblical prophecy, which were written in the law of Moses and in the prophets and in the Psalms concerning me. Psalm 16, Psalm 22, Isaiah 53. We can go on. It was prophesied. It was truth. It was witnessed. It is recorded. It always was truth. It is truth and always will be truth. That's the glory of the gospel. Back to Matthew chapter 28 as we just finish the last, if you will, part of this installment. Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 to 20, we're going to see. Following that, the saved are now sent. It's called the Great Commission, often referred to as that. Matthew 28, verse 18, and Jesus came and spake unto them. This is the resurrected Christ. All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Don't miss that. All power in heaven, all power in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations. People say, why do you go out preaching the gospel? Why do you go out bothering people with the gospel? Why do you send missionaries to other countries? Because the risen Savior told us to. And he has all power in heaven and earth. And your words of criticism, my friend, your words of condemnation mean nothing against the words of the risen Lord. I love you and I respect you and you keep your opinion, but believe truth. Submit to the word of God. Be saved. Stop fighting God. Stop fighting God's people and believe the gospel. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. You see, the saved Christians are now sent. Mark 16:15, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. The saved are sent. Christians are sent in the Lord's, in the risen Lord's power. Now that means something, doesn't it? The saved are sent in the risen Lord's presence. Christ was there present when he commissioned them. We find by the study of the truth of the gospel, when we receive Christ as our Savior, he comes to dwell within us. We're in him, in Christ. Read the book of Ephesians. It's all about being in Christ. And we are in him and he is in us. We're sent in the risen Lord's power to preach the gospel to all the world. We're sent in the risen Lord's presence. All the saved have the presence of the risen Lord. And we're sent with the risen Lord's message. And in essence, we go back to where we started. What is the message? The message is the gospel, the glory of the gospel. How that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures, and that he was seen first of Cephas and then by above 500 brethren at once. He was witnessed. Do you know him? Do you know the gospel? Do you know the Savior? Don't talk to me about your religion when I'm talking to you about a relationship. Do you know Christ? Are you saved? 1 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 16 says this, and without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up into glory. And God just records that as a fact and without controversy. People say there's much controversy. How can he? Not to God, there isn't. Not to the Christian, there isn't. There is nothing controversial. This is a book of truth. The only controversy is if you will not believe the truth, because then you have a controversy with God, my friend. Let me just turn to Romans. Please turn with me if you'd like to Romans chapter 1. The resurrection truth. Wonderful truth. Empowering truth. The resurrection life. Christians live their life in resurrection power and presence. Romans chapter 1 verse 1. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, separated unto the gospel of God, which he had promised afore by his prophets in the holy scriptures, concerning his son Jesus Christ our Lord, which was made of the seed of David according to the flesh, God incarnate, and declared to be the Son of God with power, according to the Spirit of holiness, by the resurrection from the dead. Now go to Colossians chapter 3. It's Resurrection Sunday. The Lord is risen. The glory of the gospel is set forth. Do you know that truth, my friend? Colossians chapter 3, verse 1. If ye then be risen with Christ, are you saved? If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth, present tense, at the right hand, on the right hand of God. Set your affection, your desires, your thoughts, set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, he's coming again. Is he coming as your Savior or is he coming as your judge? But he's coming again. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. He's coming with the saints. And in light of that truth, what are Christians told? Mortify, which means put to death, therefore, your members which are upon the earth. Fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence and covetousness, which is idolatry. For which things sake the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience. Our risen Lord is coming again. And because in light of this heavenly truth, in light of the glory of the gospel, Christian, God says, get your life in order. Live for the Lord. Get heavenly minded and be some earthly use. Be sanctified. But he says to you who are not saved, the wrath of God is coming on the children of disobedience. I've said it before and I'm going to say it again tonight. The gospel, the glory of the gospel, I hope has been unveiled before your eyes this morning and this evening. COVID-19, little shot across the bow from God. Christ is coming again. The wrath of God is coming. Read Revelation chapter 6 verses, Revelation chapter 6 all the way through to Revelation chapter 21 and see what is facing you in your future. If you are not saved, if you have not received the gospel, read that, my friend, because this is nothing. Value your eternal soul. See the glory of the gospel. Believe that Christ died for your sins, was buried for your sins, and rose again for your sins, and he's a risen, living, ascended Savior who is coming again. Don't meet him as your judge. Know him today as your Savior. Oh, friend, the gospel is truthful. The gospel is glorious. Believe it. Father, we thank you for Jesus Christ. Father, I pray that somehow, some way, by your Spirit, I've somehow been able to just open up a glimpse of the fullness of the glory of the gospel today. And Father, there are so many things that are unrevealed, so many things unspoken. Lord, I pray that I've not failed in the task that you set before me. And Father, I ask that you would make up for any failings, faults, and fumblings on my part today. God, I pray that every saved person who's with us today has been stirred again, has had a fresh look at the book again, a fresh, if you will, revelation of the truth of our glorious Savior and the glorious gospel. But more importantly than that, I pray, dear God, that if there be only one sinner today, only one lost person today, that this very day, this very moment, will now believe in Jesus Christ, believe on the Lord and be saved, call upon his holy name, believing in their heart the gospel, this very moment would receive Christ and be saved for all eternity, then God, what a glorious blessing that would be. Father, impress upon the heart, impress upon the conscience of the lost. There's no time to debate and deliberate. There's no time. They've been presented with truth. Father, I pray that some lost soul, one or two or more, would this very night come into the light, believing the truth, receiving the gospel, receiving Christ as their Savior. In his glorious and precious name, we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, we want to thank you for being with us throughout the day today. Pray you've been blessed by the word of God. We've been blessed by knowing that you're there, been blessed by this day and our conversations that we've been able to have with the saved. But above all, I pray you've been blessed by the word of God and the Spirit of God. Let's sing as we close our service out together this evening, 185 for those who are using hymn books. The truth we've just tried to expound as well as we possibly could. 185, Jesus paid it all. You've got nothing to add. God has done it. Will you believe it? Jesus paid it all.
Strength indeed is small.
Thank you for joining with us this blessed Resurrection Sunday. May the Lord watch you, guide you, and keep you. If you're not saved, may you know Him tonight. Come to Christ tonight. Know the risen Savior tonight. If you have any questions or anything you don't understand, then please get in touch with us. Our contact details are there on the Facebook page, newhopebaptistgo.uk, for the website as well. Please don't remain in error. Please don't remain unsaved. Please don't remain with your trust in man and religion. Come to the relationship, the saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. We'd love to hear from you if you're saved, by the way. We'd love to help you, but we'd certainly love to rejoice with you and praise the Lord with you. Thank you for being with us today. Don't forget, those of you from the church, if you'd like to send your prayer requests in, email, text, WhatsApp, send them in before the prayer meeting on Thursday. And Lord willing, I look forward to seeing you all then at 7 p.m. for our Bible study via live stream, then afterwards for our prayer meeting in privacy together. Lord bless you. Thank you for joining us today. And may you know the power and presence of the risen Lord. God bless you.